Well, thank you. First of all, I want to begin by thanking the Anelsis, and I think they provide us with a breath of fresh air, and they provide the country which is hungry for food for thought with food for thought. So let's give a round of applause for all the people who are behind this effort. I think they deserve it. And Jonathan, let's say, I mean, this was an impressive presentation, and the book is also impressive. But somehow I have the feeling for the last few months, you know, when I go to different fora like this around the world and talk with people like you, that we're going through a global group therapy, trying to say to each other, yeah, everything will be okay, you know, don't worry about it. But that was reassuring. Your presentation was reassuring. But I want to ask you whether it's possible in a democracy, because some of the countries you refer to are not democracies, are illiberal democracies. Can you actually work through these reforms and demand this kind of courage from political leaders who work within a specific time framework?
Look, there's no question that in some ways making big, deep, painful reforms is easier in an autocracy, just like doing lots of things is easier in an authoritarian government. But the fact of the matter is that these changes are possible in democracies as well. And the majority of the countries in my book were, in fact, democracies. It's harder. And what it requires is somebody as a leader who not just doesn't just have the skills that I already mentioned, but is able to master both the policymaking process and the political process. And finding both of those strengths in a single individual is somewhat unusual. But I would argue that democracies also have strengths which non-democratic or weak democratic countries lack, and that gives them assets which contributes to their evolution. One, of course, is the fact that governments change frequently, and so the people have the opportunity to throw out the bums if what they're doing doesn't work. But democracies also provide the kind of intellectual breathing space that allows ideas and best practices to circulate. And that proves critical in governments as they search for solutions, because you have cultures of think tanks and academics who are able to think and write and argue freely and contribute to the process of working out these really hard problems. And it also proves critical to a country's economic development. You know, one of the countries that I write about, which I think I mentioned already, is South Korea. And the story of South Korea's economic miracle is a long one. It starts in 1960 and it goes all the way up through today. And during that period, South Korea, which started life in 1960 as one of the poorest places on earth, it was poorer than Ghana and Iraq, is now the 13th wealthiest country on the planet with a highly enviable lifestyle. And Korea went through several stages and phases during that long process of economic evolution. It started the process under an authoritarian government, but it would never have gotten where it is today. It would never have gotten truly rich if it hadn't made the transition to democracy, because it was the opening up of the country that allowed for the weakening of the corrupt oligopolistic the conglomerates, chaebol, they're known in Korea, which had been responsible for its early success but were starting to smother its development because they were keeping small businesses and entrepreneurs from getting started. And they also allowed South Korea to make the transition to an innovation economy, to a knowledge economy, which would never have happened under an authoritarian regime where people don't have the freedom to think and write and experiment freely.
But, you know, the problem is, you know, when you talk to politicians in Greece or around Europe, for example, and you talk to them about reforms, labor reforms, pension reforms, they refer always to Schröder. They say, look what happened to Schröder. You know, he was the man behind the success that Germany is experiencing now. He was the architect of all the reforms, but he was voted out, and somebody else is ripping off the benefits.
I mean, this happens, and this points to a big risk which we have to acknowledge. And it's one of the reasons that so few politicians actually do the hard work of making big sweeping structural reforms, which is that the political life cycle in electoral democracies where leaders have to go to the voters every 3 to 5 years for a new mandate, that does not align very well with the tempo of structural reforms, which often take more than 3 or 4 or 5 years to bear fruit. And what that means is that leaders often don't get to enjoy the benefits of the hard work that they do while they're still in office. In fact, just the opposite, they can suffer because all of the special interests who they had to oppose campaign very hard against them. And that's one of several reasons why Peña Nieto is suffering so badly in Mexico today. There are others, but one of them is that all of these big economic reforms, which I just mentioned, haven't yet started to pay off and make the lives of ordinary Mexicans better. Now, I'm convinced, and most economists are, that that will happen eventually and in the not-too-distant future, but it won't be soon enough to save Peña Nieto.
And you actually think that you can have reforms during a crisis, because the experience we've had here, for example, was it's very difficult to convince people when you cut their salaries and their pensions and so on. Every time they hear the word reform, they look at their pocket to see if there's any money missing.
Right.
So can you actually combine reforms and crisis?
I mean, I think it's actually, not only can you do it, it's essential, because as I mentioned in my talk, without reforms, politicians rarely have the kind of freedom to push through difficult changes. Now, part of the problem that you have in Greece, and I'm reluctant to say too much about Greece because, as will quickly become obvious, I'm not an expert on the country, but crisis and reform has gotten a very bad name in this country, because for 8 years now, the politicians in office have been blaming the reforms on external forces. They haven't been owning themselves, and they haven't been doing enough to make the reforms far-reaching as they need to be to allow for businesses to recover. And politicians who are out of office attack the government. So everybody is saying crisis is bad and that reform is bad. But Greece is not the way that things happen in everywhere. And I would argue it's a failure of the political class here that crisis and reform has taken on such a bad reputation.
I'll get back to Greece in the end, because the narrative of the lulafication of Tsipras is one of my favorites. I won't discuss this, but at the end. Now, one of the big challenges that the Western democracies face, and not only Western democracies, is the challenge of social media. It's very difficult to communicate with part of the population which doesn't read the Foreign Affairs, New York Times, or Kathmandu for that matter. They get their info from social media and so on. And all they get from there is simplistic answers, populism, reinforcing their own anger and so on. How do you deal with that challenge?
It's a very difficult question. I get asked often, when I talk about the book, what are the subjects that you wish that you'd included that you didn't? And one is the rise of populism, but another is the degradation of politics in the West, for which the rise of social media and the fracturing of the media environment is responsible for. You know, one of the ironies of what's happening today is 5, 6, 7, 10 years ago, people were talking about social media as though it was the salvation of democracy, because it was finally breaking the oligarchy of the big media conglomerates who got to decide on our behalf what was news, what wasn't, and they played this kind of filtering role. And people argued that when that filter finally disappeared, that citizens would finally have access to the real truth. Well, in fact, the opposite is what happened. And we now face a big problem in trying to address that. And I don't have a good answer for it. I'll be completely frank about it rather than trying to fake my way through an answer. But I do think it's the case that even in today's media environment, people know what's happening in their lives. They understand their economic situation pretty well, and they know if they're suffering economic pain, and they also notice when things start to get a little bit better. And so what I strongly believe is that as the right policies are put in place that start to address people's complaints, despite the fact that so much of the population now only reads media that confirms their pre-existing ideas, they will see how their lives are changing for the better. Having said that, again, this is another one of these real-life experiments that we're going to see unfold with Trump, because I'm convinced that this government is going to manage to accomplish almost nothing over the course of the next 4 years, that none of the major legislative priorities are going to get passed because these guys are so unbelievably incompetent that they don't even know how to get legislation through government. What that means is that the core Trump constituency, which are mostly white, working class, non-college educated Americans who have suffered a lot over the last two decades as a result of globalization, but even more of technology, they're going to see that the government is not doing anything. Now, Trump will try to fight that perception by conducting these Potemkin exercises, which he's already gotten very good at, where he goes to a factory for air conditioners in Indiana that was claiming or that was preparing to move jobs to Mexico, 500 or 50 jobs, and he makes a big speech saying, look, I've just saved American workers, even though the numbers are incredibly small. And there will be a lot of these theatrics. And meanwhile, Trump will also continue to try and bewilder us by changing the subject, not even once a day, but five or six times a day, which makes it incredibly difficult to remember what happened this morning, let alone yesterday. But nonetheless, I strongly feel that, or suspect that after 3 or 4 years, if ordinary people don't feel that their, and I shouldn't say ordinary people, what I mean is Trump voters don't feel that their lives are improving, they're going to turn on the guy that they elected.
Now, the question is Trump and populism a product of the failure of the elites as well? Have the elites in the West become too complacent?
Absolutely, and it's a failure of the political system and of politicians to do what policymakers have been promising to do for many, many years. After November, after the U.S. election, a lot of people started arguing that this very frightening result was so was such a sea change, was such a dramatic shift, represented such a big shift, that we needed to completely rethink the way that government operated in the United States. My argument is that's actually not true. Partly because Trump didn't win a popular mandate. He lost the popular vote by more than 3 million people. And but for the intervention of the Russian government and the FBI director, Hillary Clinton, who was a terrible candidate, still would have won the election. I just lost my train of thought. Remind me.
Yeah, well, I was,
by the way, is jet lag. In my own defense, I arrived yesterday and didn't sleep at all last night.
Oh, yeah, doing well.
The political establishment.
Yes.
Thank you. So to get back to
complacency
that.
Of the elites. Yes.
Thank you.
Yes.
I think that at their core, the reason that American voters, and those are the ones I should speak to because it's the situation I understand the best, were so mad, these core Trump voters, was because for 20 or 30 years, since the government of Bill Clinton at least, American governments had been promising and promising and promising that they were going to help insulate them and protect them from all of these very bewildering and threatening changes brought on by the changes in the shifts in the American economy caused by technology and globalization. And the political class didn't do it. And so people got angrier and angrier and angrier. And what happened in November 8th, 2016 was 40 million Americans decided that they were pissed off and they wanted to break something. And they did it. They broke it. But nonetheless, I believe that if the political elites, which were too complacent, actually start delivering on their promises, that this can have a major impact on public opinion.
But do you also think that the elite, especially in the US, became too politically correct?
I'm not sure what you mean by that, because it's a word that gets used in lots of different ways in the US and it has very different meanings depending on who's using it. If you're talking about identity politics and the fact that the Democrats under Hillary Clinton focused too much on social issues and all of the incredible social progress that was made under Obama, and the fact that the country's first woman president was going to keep pushing this stuff, and neglected to focus on people's core economic concerns. I would agree with the second half of the statement more than the first half of the statement. I mean, I think that there was nothing wrong with emphasizing the social change because that had actually made an enormous difference in many, many people's lives during the 8 years of the Obama administration. I mean, think about it. We had the United States' first African-American president. We had the first Latino justice on the U.S. Supreme Court. For the first time, gay people were allowed to marry. Equality was extended to people across the LGBTQ spectrum. They were allowed to serve in the military. In fact, the military dropped its gender requirements as well. So all of a sudden, they shifted to a system now where as long as you can fulfill the tasks involved with any job in the U.S. military, you can do it regardless of what gender you happen to be. I mean, these are incredible changes, and they deserve to be celebrated.
And do you think that the Trump election has become sort of a wake-up call?
I hope that it has been. We're not seeing much reinvention yet on the Democratic side, on the left. It certainly highlighted that there are all of these issues that need to be addressed, and that the focus of politics on the left needs to change, and that the coalitions need to change as well. But what we don't yet see is a strategy emerging. But it's very, very early days, and I suspect what will happen is we'll start to see the Democratic candidates, the promising next leaders of the party, emerge first, and then the policies will come afterwards.
Now, you talked about the first few months of the Trump administration. We call it the Varoufakis episode in the U.S. version in some ways. Do you think the grown-ups have gotten the upper hand now at the White House and the key decision-making places?
Yeah, I mean, all the signs that I see suggest that that is what's happening, that the people like Defense Secretary Mattis and Homeland Security Secretary Kelly and Tillerson at State, and most of all Jared Kushner, the president's son-in-law, are winning or have won the internal battles against the racist, lunatic ideologues like Steve Bannon. But remember, while that's good news, it's not great news, because all it means is that the insane amateurs are now being replaced by sane amateurs. But the sane people are still amateurs. None of them have any experience with government. And so that's why I think we will continue to see that the rhetoric may calm down, and the scandal and the turmoil may decrease. But I don't expect us to see a lot more actual substantive progress.
Is there anything like a Trump foreign policy doctrine you can see somewhere on the horizon? Or?
I mean, it varies depending on the day. And he is so reactive that predicting what he's going to do next, which of course is the purpose of a doctrine, is virtually impossible. And I'll just mention two quick examples. So, some now month ago or so, Trump, who had said that he was never going to get involved in a conflict with the Assad government in Syria, after seeing on television, which is where he gets all of his information, that the government had used chemical weapons against the people, decided to launch a missile strike, which was actually pretty effective in the sense that it was moderate and it didn't lead to an expansion of the conflict. It didn't draw the United States in. So it worked on that level. It may have sent a message not just to the Syrian government, but also to the Russian government and also to the Chinese government, that Trump means business. But the very next day, his Secretary of State and his UN representative got out and said diametrically opposed things about what the new doctrine, the U.S. doctrine and the approach to Syria was going to be, so that by 24 hours later, we still had no clue, and to this day we have no clue what the new U.S. approach to Syria and to the Assad government is going to be, except that if Trump sees that chemical weapons are being used on babies and gets upset about it, there will probably be more missiles launched. The other example that I'll mention is, in recent days and weeks, North Korea's behavior has become more and more provocative as it advances closer and closer to having a small nuclear missile that it's able to mount on a ballistic weapon able to reach the United States. And that's the real crisis moment that American war planners are terrified of. So you would think under these circumstances, the United States government would be working very, very closely with its allies in the region, countries like Japan and especially South Korea, for example. And in fact, the Trump administration had been saying lots of very positive things about the South Korean government. One day last week, it did two things the same day. Trump did two things the same day. First of all, he announced that the U.S. government was not going to pay for the this new anti-missile system known as THAAD, which the U.S. had built and installed and is about to become operational in South Korea, shocking everybody in the Korean political establishment. And he announced that the U.S. was going to abandon the U.S.-Korea Free Trade Agreement. And so these were, I mean, two unbelievable kick in the balls to the Korean political establishment that seemed to, they came out of nowhere and were totally unmotivated. And we'll have the ironic result of helping to ensure the victory of a liberal and a potentially anti-American president in the Korean election, which is now 2 days away. So that suggests that there is absolutely no policy involved. And this guy's, what we think of as a mind-to-mouth filter, is so bad that he just says whatever pops into his head at the moment and doesn't care about the consequences. And all of this talk that he's deliberately utilizing a Nixon madman strategy, which is trying to seem crazy to put the fear into U.S. enemies. I mean, I think that it's true that he likes the idea of scaring U.S. adversaries and friends, for that matter. But to call it a strategy is a stretch.
Now, do you think American hegemony is over? Are we moving into a truly multipolar world?
Eventually, yes. But the question is, when does eventually come to pass? You know, as the Chinese Premier Zhou Enlai famously said about the French Revolution, right? It's when asked about whether it had not been successful, he said, "Well, it's too soon to tell." And similarly, as economists say, you know, when talking about the future, they all like to remind us that in the future we'll all be dead, right? So, U.S. hegemony is passing. The trends all point in that direction, but U.S. predominance in terms of military hard power and in terms of economic power and things like innovation and the U.S. educational system are so overwhelming, and U.S. military spending is still, you know, it still outnumbers. U.S. spends more on its military every year than the next eight countries combined, and that's not going to change every year. And although you hear a lot about the Chinese ramping up their military spending by 5 or 10% a year, they're so far back technologically that it's going to be a long time before they can challenge the U.S. at the big game. But what is happening under this administration is we're seeing a retreat from U.S. global leadership. And we're seeing a retreat from the support of the global rules-based international system, which the U.S. and its allies helped create after the end of the Second World War, and which has been responsible for so much prosperity around the world. And as the U.S. withdraws from that, that system will get weaker. And as the U.S. becomes less engaged in providing public goods like policing global sea lanes, for example, other countries are going to step into the gap. But here, again, I'll say, so far that's happened on a mostly rhetorical level. And U.S. behavior in areas like sending its ships around the world to ensure free navigation, that hasn't changed.
And how do you see Europe in this context? Could the fix work in Europe, which is a continent that's growing older? It's facing a lot of challenges, and it's not exactly famous for its let's say, support of reforms?
Well, I mean, there are several Europes, right? I could have written a story, of a chapter about how Norway has handled its oil resources, or about how Denmark adopted a flexible social welfare system that, on the one hand, it cut labor regulations and made it easier for companies to fire employees and removed other worker protections, which caused new business growth. But at the same time, it increased social welfare spending to ensure that when people did lose their jobs, the government would be there to help them make the transition. And that's worked incredibly well. But in Southern Europe, and Southern Europe part starts pretty high up, the picture is a lot less rosy. And certainly, if we're talking about Europe with a capital E and talking about the EU, things look even less positive. But there is certainly room for the kind of policies that I talk about in the book, whether it's immigration or inequality or how to combat slow growth, et cetera.
Now, how do you see Greece from the outside? I mean, you've been here for a couple of days, but obviously you've been reading about Greece. We've been in the news for the wrong reasons. So how do you see Greece?
Well, you know, one of the interesting things for me was when I started doing my preparations for the trip, I suddenly recognized that I was feeling very insecure about coming here and talking about Greece because I hadn't been reading anything about Greece. And I went back and I thought, ask myself, was this because I've become lazy? Or is it because actually the Western press has stopped covering Greece? And it's the latter. There have been almost no stories about Greece in the Western media in the last year. That's because the perception is that things have kind of stabilized. And I guess there's some truth to that. Having been here for now all of 36 hours or something, I find confirmation of that. There does seem to be a sense of a greater sense of stability than there were a few years ago. It's a very pessimistic sense, but it's there nonetheless. I was curious to see whether some of the conservative macroeconomic policies that Syriza had been forced to adopt were signs of an actual maturation of the party, again, based on the few people that I've spoken to since I've been here. That doesn't seem to be the case, although you should all feel free to argue with me if you think that that's wrong. So what I see is that the wolf may not be at the door in quite the way that it was just a few years ago, but that Greece has yet to make the kind of deep and important reforms that would allow its economy to revive. I'm talking about things like cutting regulations, about tax and banking reform that would allow for the creation of larger corporations of the kind that Greece has historically never had because of the emphasis on small family-owned and entrepreneurial businesses here. Those changes haven't happened yet. And it doesn't seem like the current government has much appetite for it, but the good news that I see, which suggests that there's growing pragmatism in the population, if not in the government, is what the polls are saying about the next election, although that's still some way away, I know.
You know, one of the Greek paradoxes that Dimitri referred to is the fact that, to be fair, not just this government, but previous governments during the crisis, they blame the reforms on the outsiders, on the lenders and so on. Two questions. Have you seen this in other cases, and does it ever work?
Sure. I mean, lots of countries that got bailouts in the 90s, including countries during the Asian financial crisis in 97, 98, turned around and blamed the international neoliberal conspiracy for imposing these unpopular reforms on them. That didn't tend to work. I mean, it worked politically in the short term, just as it worked in Greece in the short term politically. But what it didn't do was allow those governments any room to then make the kind of economic reforms that were still needed because they had just come to power by demonizing precisely those agendas. And the countries that did actually manage to make deeper reforms that set them up for failure were the countries that embraced what they were being required to do and took those reforms even further. And here, my example is South Korea, which was hit very hard by the 1997-1998 Asian financial crisis. Now, what that crisis did was allow for the election of an outsider, a leftist named Kim Dae-jung, who would never have won power otherwise. But once he came into office, he was smart enough, and this makes him one of the star pragmatists of my book, to drop his leftist ideology in the sense that he stopped attacking international institutions and went much farther than the IMF required in breaking down the power of Korea's big monopolies, for example. But he remained true to his constituency by following taking a page from the Scandinavians and putting in place new social protections of the kind that I was describing in the Danish example. So he did both things. But he didn't do it by continuing to blame outside forces.
Now Ferguson has developed this theory that perhaps Greece could become the new Argentina, experiencing a Macri effect, perhaps with the next government. Do you buy that, or can you see that?
Look, if it could happen in Argentina, right, which was an incredible basket case, while also sharing some of the assets that Greece has, like high human capital, although it's even higher here than it is in Argentina, then I don't see why it can't happen, although it would require a huge shift in political culture.
Now, if you had the chance to sit down with our Prime Minister, Mr. Tsipras, and talk about what he should do to go the Lula way, what are the three things you tell him to do?
Number one, read my book. Of course, buy my book. No, number one is buy my book. Number two,
we can send him that. That's you know, okay. That's a service. No,
but I want him to pay for it.
Okay.
The one thing that I would start and end with is to, insofar as it's possible, abandon political ideology and to focus on pragmatic reforms and not worry so much about whether these are traditional policy planks of Syriza or of related parties, but focus instead on what will be effective and to recognize that that's the way he's going to ultimately make lives better for the very voters who brought him into office in the first place, not by just continuing to stick to the party line.
And what advice would you give to your own president? Stop tweeting or?
Stop what?
Stop tweeting or?
To our own president. Yeah. I would take all of his mobile devices away from him, and I would suggest that he go into a room, shut the doors, and watch television, and let the cabinet run the government for the next 4 years. It wouldn't be a great 4 years, but it would be better than the four that we may have.
Okay, great. Thank you, Jonathan.
Thank you.
Thank you.